Well, good morning, and certainly want to welcome all who are with us today to the services here at Southside Church of Christ in Williamston. It's good to be back. I've been away for a number of weeks. Some of those were due to travels, others because of inclement weather, and I guess most of us can appreciate that, probably being part of it in some respect. I was telling Tracy and Ricky, I think you guys had mostly an ice event down here. We had about 10 inches of snow up in Newport News, and that is very uncommon for that part of the world. When I first moved there in the military back in the late 70s, I remember calling home and telling my dad that I missed the snow, having grown up in the south central part of Pennsylvania. His response to me was, "If you missed the snow, you didn't shovel enough of it when you were at home." And he's probably right. I know I spent a lot more time playing in it than I did shoveling in it, and so maybe that's why I still have a childlike fascination for it, even as an aged man. But good to have you all. Let me invite you to be turning to Matthew chapter 16, please. Matthew chapter 16. And while you're doing that, do want to make just a couple preliminary observations. First of all, so good to have some visitors in our midst. We are a small group of folks, and when we have visitors, we are always delighted. And we do pray that your time with us will be spiritually enriching. And please let us know if there's any way that we might help you in your spiritual walk in Christ. Another thing is I try to, at the end of each year, and I know we're a couple weeks into the new year now, but try to, at the end of each year, to attempt to express in a small way, in words, my appreciation for what this congregation means to me. And so I've done that. I will post that on the board, anyone who would care to read it. And you can expect it's lengthy, as usually I'm rather wordy. But I wanted to let you know that that was there, especially for the members who would care to read it. Another thing, my travels took me to, again, my home area in Pennsylvania, which is very close to Hershey. As they advertise it, the sweetest place on earth. And so every time I go to Hershey, I try to stop by Chocolate World and pick up some candies. So my family always tells me to them it tastes fresher. I've never had any appreciation for that. Chocolate is chocolate. I'm not sure you can improve on it. Put peanut butter in it. That will help. But anyways, I brought back some candies from Chocolate World in Hershey. And I would ask of you to take as much as you'd like. Brought some baggies that you can put it in for a little carry package home and share it with your loved ones. Only thing I would ask is save a little bit for Tanya and Irene. I know they like Hershey's chocolates, and they're not here. They're not here today, and so I'm going to try to leave a little bit for them next week, Lord willing, in their return. We do want to remember them. We do want to pray for their safe return. And finally, I wanted to thank Tim especially. As one of our visitors, we imposed upon him to lead us in singing. It did a great job. Thank you, Tim. And the only reason for that is just some circumstances as it relates to Ricky. And so we thank you for stepping up and doing such a marvelous job. And even though I didn't coordinate this in any way, that last song we sang really provides an excellent segue into our reading, because we were singing about standing on the promises of God. And the section of scripture we're about to read here in Matthew chapter 16 includes a promise made by God in the person of Jesus. And so let me invite your attention there to Matthew chapter 16, beginning in verse 13. A very quick reading of the initial verses, and then we'll slow down when we get closer toward the end of this passage. But verse 13 sets the stage for us. When Jesus came into the coasts of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And just by way of context, to maybe help us appreciate why the disciples would have been very qualified to answer that question, they just returned from the limited commission. They had been out talking about the kingdom of heaven was now at hand. And maybe they had an opportunity to introduce people to Jesus of Nazareth. And maybe they were hearing people's opinions with regard to who this unusual man in their presence was. And so they answered maybe some of those opinions that they had heard during that mission. And so they said in verse 14, some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But then Jesus said to them, his disciples, whom do you say that I am? And friends, that's really the only answer that matters. For each of us, individually, personally, whom do we say that Jesus is? People have a lot of different opinions. And those opinions might be interesting to hear and to think about, but the only one that really matters to each of us is whom we say that he is. Peter, impetus, always ready to give an answer. He's the one that spoke up first, and he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. To those other opinions of men, Jesus gave no response, but that response by Peter warranted this answer. Verse 17, Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Friends, Peter's answer was the right answer. Peter's answer is the answer that each of us should give to the question, whom do you say that Jesus, the Son of Man, is? Friends, he is the Christ, the anointed of God, the Messiah of the Old Testament, the promised one who would come to reconcile man back to God. He is the Son of the living God. So we can say amen to Peter's answer. But did you notice the promise in Jesus' response to Peter? He acknowledged who Peter is, and then he gave recognition to the foundational fact that Peter just affirmed, that Jesus is the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, on that rock ledge, on that rock, I promise to do something. He says, I promise to build my church. Interesting. This is the first time in the New Testament that the word church will be found. And it is Jesus who claims ownership to it by the personal pronoun my church, who claims to be the architect of it when he says, I will build it. He makes that promise. Now, friends, the reason that is a meaningful promise to us in our study is because we have been recently engaged in a series of studies talking about God's purpose for the church. And again, here is God in the person of Jesus, the incarnate Christ. Here is God talking for the first time in the New Testament about the church. And so, obviously, that should have great significance to our study with regards to God's purpose for the church. One of the promises Christ made is, I'll build it. I'll build it. Now, again, we can and will probably have occasion to come back to this promise. But please understand how it fits in even further to the development of our first major point. Because as it relates to God's purpose for the church, we first of all asserted that it is a place of revelation. And for those who were not present with us during our first study, let me tell you where we derive that truth from. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. Because here is the Apostle Paul, writing by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, talking about the church And in the same context, talking about it being according to God's purpose. God's purpose. And that's why we pose this title, God's Purpose for the Church. The first thing we discern here from verse 11 is, it is according to the eternal purpose which He, God, purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. What is according to the eternal purpose of God? Well, friends, all we have to do is back up to the previous verse, verse 10, and we find out what it is that Paul says is according to the eternal purpose of God. It's the church. It's the church. And so here is Paul, and he is basically illuminating the brethren there with regards to his mission, God-given mission, of making known through the gospel the mystery of God that it had been hidden in ages past. So what was that mystery, Paul? Verse 9, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. To the intent, this was part of the mystery, now revealed. To the intent that now, under the principalities and powers in heavenly places, might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Again, according to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Did you notice not only can we discern from these verses that the church is according to God's eternal purpose, but in that purpose God intended for it to be a place that would manifest some things. The word manifest means to make known, to reveal. And here specifically, Paul identifies one of the things that God purposed or intended for the church to reveal about Him. What is that? Again, go back to verse 10. That He might make known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Friends, when you see the church, you ought to have a great appreciation for the wisdom of God. And we talked about a number of the ways in which the church manifests the manifold. The word means many variated or many fold, many sided wisdom of God. But the second point we suggested, under this being God's purpose for the church, a place of revelation, making known some things about God Himself, not only was it intended to reveal the wisdom of God, but also the power of God. And that's the point that we last introduced when we were together. The power of God. Now, friends, whether or not we can point to a verse that is so evident with regards to this answer, I believe with a little thought and reasoning, we can appreciate this answer. Would you agree with me that even if somebody devised a plan and purposed something, and even if there was wisdom behind it, it would remain just that, a plan, a purpose, an intention, unless that individual had the power to bring it about? You see, if God did not have power that allowed Him to fulfill what He planned and purposed, it would have remained just that, a plan, an intention, a purpose that was unfulfilled, incomplete, never brought to fruition. And so the very fact that the church does exist in keeping with God's wise plan testifies to the fact that God has the power to do what He said He would do. And so that's one of the reasons that we suggest that when you look at the church, when you see the church, you ought to have a great appreciation for the power of God. The power of God. Now, we eventually hopefully soon, but we're eventually going to get back to the promise that Jesus made back in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 13. But before we do that, let me just help us appreciate and by way of review, remember what we said about the first evidence of power seen in the church's existence. We're going to come to see that Acts chapter 2 is where the church first came into existence here on earth. But I call that to your attention because I'd ask you to look at chapter 3, Acts chapter 3. Now the church has come into existence. It's here on the earth. It's there in the city of Jerusalem. But now Peter, who was present for that inauguration in Jerusalem, has remained in the same city. And he and John performed a miracle by the power of God that called people's attention to them, and they gave him a hearing. And so he's again preaching here in Acts chapter 3 in the same city, in the same temple. But a second sermon that is recorded for us in the book of Acts. And Peter's going to talk about those days that were now present. Notice what he says about those days. Verse 20, he's talking about Jesus Christ, who is central to what has happened here in Jerusalem. He shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, notice, which God has spoken by the mouth of all His holy prophets since the world began. He mentions one of those prophecies, Moses. But drop down, if you will. Look at verse 24. Yea, and all the prophets, not just Moses. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Now think about that, friends. What Peter is affirming is, God, from the beginning of time, from the earliest of the prophets, Moses and then Samuel and all those who followed after, were predicting, were making prophecies, were offering promises with regards to what has now taken place. How were they able to do that? Friends, we have people with great scientific capabilities, instrumentality. We can't get the weather right for the next day. There were a lot of people surprised at the outcome of the election of a few months back, because there were a lot of predictions being made. Those predictions never came to pass. You see, man doesn't have the ability to say something is going to happen and then guarantee that it will happen. But God does. In fact, as we read on that occasion a couple weeks ago, in Isaiah 46, beginning in verse 5, God asked, or God says of Himself, I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, My counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. You see, what God is saying, in contrast to the idols that had no power, and yet His people were putting their confidence and trust in them, God said, Who is like me? Who can declare the end from the beginning? By way of application, who could have, from Moses throughout all of the Old Testament, who could have been informing those prophets to make promises of what God would do and then have it come to pass exactly as He said it? Friends, there's only one way God could have done that, is because He is powerful. God is omnipowerful, omnipotent. There's no limitation to His power. Friends, time doesn't even limit God's power. God can make promises and prophecies, and despite the amount of time that has interceded, He can have them come to pass. There's the power of God. And when you see the church, and when you understand that was in the eternal purpose of God, from before the foundation of the earth, that was in God's plan and purposes, and then He made predictions about it, where it would begin, when it would begin, who would be part and parcel of it, how it would come to pass, when God could make promises like that and then fulfill every one. There's power. When you see the church, you ought to have an appreciation for God's revelation of His power. But friends, not only in His ability to tell the future and ensure that it would come to pass, but now let me direct you back to the promise of Jesus. Return with me to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, and look more closely at that particular promise. Because here's what Jesus says with regards to His role as it relates to the church. He says, Peter, your affirmation about Me, your conviction about who I am is true, and that truth will become the foundational fact upon which I will. First of all, friends, I will build. That's future. So at this juncture in Jesus' earthly ministry, it hasn't been built. It's not yet in existence. Jesus is still talking about it, again, as the prophets had, as though it's something yet future. I will build My church. Again, even in that, we can see the power of God because now the church exists. But if that is not astounding enough, think about the power that was necessary in the other component of the promise. And the gates of Hades. Please read that as Hades and not hell. Sadly, if you're using a King James Version, and that is the version of the Bible I use, and I'm not suggesting that they didn't have, in their day and time, reason to translate that hell, but when we think of the word hell, what do we think of? We think of the place of the condemned when this world is over. That's not the word Jesus is using. And had the translators translated it more in keeping with our understanding, they would have translated it, really transliterated it, into the word Hades. You ever heard that word before? Get to watch a lot of Disney movies nowadays because I got little grandchildren. They love Disney. And, I forget, it had to do with one of the sons of Zeus, what was that guy's name? Hercules, thank you. Hercules. If you ever saw Hercules, you were introduced to Hades. He was the Greek god over the unseen world. That's where dead people went. That's when the body was separated from the soul, the spirit went to Hades, the Hadean realm. It had no bearing on whether they were righteous or unrighteous. Now again, the Greeks didn't have that understanding, but that's where the word comes from, Hades. Now, he says, Jesus says, the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Prevail against what? The promise he just made. The gates of Hades, the realm of death, will not keep me from building My church. See what he was promising? I'm sure his disciples at this point had no idea what he was saying. Brother H. Leo Bowles, in his commentary on Matthew, I thought helps us make connection to the word power initially with this promise. He says there, ancient cities were surrounded by walls with gates. These gates were often assaulted in battle and were guarded by special garrisons. The protection of the city was estimated by the strength of its gates. Hence, the word gates became synonymous with powers. The gates of Hades means the power of Hades. Hades was originally the name of the god who presided over the realm of the dead, hence the phrase house of Hades. It designates the place to which all who depart this life descend without reference to their moral character. In the New Testament, Hades is the realm of the dead. Here, Hades is represented as a mighty city with gates representing its power. Jesus simply meant that though he would be crucified, buried, yet he would arise from the dead and build his church. The powers of death, or the unseen world, or the gates of Hades would not be able to hold him in the unseen realm and prevent his coming out and building his church. Friends, when Jesus made this promise, that's what he was alluding to. Jesus was saying, I'm going to build my church, but first, I'm going to go to the Hadean realm. Now again, had the disciples understood that, they might have inquired of Jesus, but now we do understand it. Jesus was saying, the power of Hades does not rival my power. And even though when we go to the Hadean realm, you remember the incident with Lazarus and the rich man? Where Abraham explained to the rich man, if you wanted to leave, you couldn't. See, you don't have the power to leave. But Jesus is saying, I have power over the powers of Hades, over the Hadean realm. No one else can leave there without God's power. But I have that power. And I am going to build my church after I die. Go to the Hadean realm, I'm going to come up out of that Hadean realm. It can't prevail. It can't in any way refrain or constrain me from coming out and doing what I've promised to do. Friends, when you see the church, you ought to have a great appreciation for its revelation of the power of God, because it would never exist unless God was powerful enough to break the gates of the Hadean realm open and allow his son to come out. That's why when you get to Ephesians, again, go back to the Ephesian letter. In Ephesians chapter 1, and we've already spent some time in this chapter, because time and time and time again in these early verses, Paul is talking about the purpose of God. The purpose of God, the purpose of God. In chapter 3, he's going to tell us what was part of that eternal purpose. It was the church. But here in the end of chapter 1, Paul is going to be, by way of a letter, telling the Ephesians of what he was praying for them. It begins there in chapter 1 and verse 15, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers that. Here were the contents of his prayers in behalf of the Ephesian brethren. And we're not going to go through all of the things that he was making petitions with regards to those brethren, but I call your attention to verse 19 following. He wanted them to know what is the exceeding greatness of His, God's power to usward who believe. You know, sometimes we don't know what to pray. Whenever I get in that situation, I go to the prayers of Paul, prayers of Daniel, prayers of my Savior, because they understood what they ought to be praying for. And you know what they're praying for? They're praying for Christians to understand, have a greater appreciation for the power of God in their lives. Paul said, I want God to somehow impress upon you His power working in you. So how do you have an appreciation for that? According to the working of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead. You want an appreciation for the power of God? You look at the resurrection of Jesus. That's where God put His power on obvious display. And Jesus says, I'm able to build the church even though I'm going to die first. In my resurrection, I will put on display the power of God, and I will come and make my promise good. I'll build the church. Not only that, but then God set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet, gave him to be a head over all things to the church. Friends, that's our subject, the church. When you see the church, when you see its existence, when you read of its existence on the pages of Scripture, what you ought to see, what you have an appreciation for, is a revelation of the power of God. Because the only way it could exist is for God in His power to raise His Son. And then after that resurrection, and He built His church, Jesus was raised to God's right hand, now given a place of supreme authority over everything, including the church. There's the power of God. You want to see it work in your life? Are you a Christian? Are you a Christian this hour? Because in chapter 2, Paul is going to continue that thought. He says that power that God put on display when He raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that raised you out of death due to sin. You see, if you're a Christian this hour, and Christians are those who comprise the church, when you see the church, you see the power of God to raise those who are spiritually dead to those who are living in Christ. Again, because of time restraints, please read that chapter 2. Read down through those beginning verses. That's what he's going to say. That same power that God put on display in the resurrection of His Son, He puts on display when He raised you out of spiritual death. But there's more. There's more. You see it in God's ability to foretell the future and to have it come to pass just as He said. You see it in the resurrection of Jesus. If Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, friends, the church doesn't exist. But it is also true, if the church does exist, Jesus was raised from the dead. There's the power of God. But friends, this power that was put on display in its preparation, in its being promised and prophesied about, and then in Jesus' establishment of it, seeing God's power put on such display, manifested, is there any surprise then that on its inauguration day, it was a day filled with power? I mentioned to you that that day is recorded for us in Acts chapter 2. Will you go first of all to Acts chapter 1 though? Acts chapter 1. Jesus has now been resurrected, been some 40 days with His disciples, speaking to them about the kingdom of God, verse 3 of chapter 1. But now they were assembled together, and Jesus is about to go to His Father, ascend back to heaven, and there sit at the right hand of God, placed over all things, including the church. But before He goes, here's another promise. Verse 4, and being assembled together with them, He commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which He says, you have heard of Me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. Friends, we don't have time to stop and look at that. But please understand, you have to understand and you have to put this verse with what John said when he was baptizing at Jordan. He said, I baptize you with water, but there is one who is coming who is mightier than I am, who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Friends, put all types of interpretations and applications on that. Here is Jesus giving us the divine interpretation. That's going to come to pass shortly in the lives of the apostles. John truly baptized with water, but you apostles, shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. verse 6, they're come together. They're asking him, Lord, is it at this time you're going to restore again the kingdom of Israel? He said unto them, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but you apostles, shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Another promise by Jesus. Very shortly, you are going to receive power that is going to qualify you to be my witnesses, first to the Jews, but then to all men. We don't have to wait long for this promise to come to fulfillment. All you have to do is turn the page, at least in my Bible. Look at chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all, the apostles, with one accord in one place. Suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. Is that powerful? It filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as fire. Is that powerful? These physical phenomena evidence power sent from God. It sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Is that power? Friends, that's supernatural power. I struggle with English. It's the only language I've ever known. Tried to learn German for about 4 years, and now I know Ich heiße Mike Brandt. These men were empowered, as Jesus had promised, were empowered by the Holy Spirit to do something supernatural. They were speaking languages that they had never learned. That's powerful. It certainly was impressive to those present because that got everyone's attention. They're saying, these are Galilean fishermen. How do they know our native tongues? Now, they tried to put all types of very peculiar interpretations on that. They even suggested they were drunk. Now, friends, again, knowing what I do about people being inebriated, they have a hard time speaking anything. Certainly couldn't speak a foreign language that they had never learned. But despite that, Peter tells them by the power that was given to him what this was all about. See, this was yet another occasion of God's prophecies coming to pass. And so he takes their minds back to Joel. He says, this is God's promise from Joel that he was going to have an outpouring of his Spirit. Friends, that was a day filled with power. The physical phenomena, sounds, sights, the ability of these Galileans to speak foreign languages that they had never learned. But friends, it was also very important for them to have the Holy Spirit empower them with knowledge. You remember Jesus said, this was the promise of my Father that I spoke of you? When he was with them on the night before his crucifixion, he had told them, my Father, when I go away, my Father is going to send to you the Holy Spirit. And he's going to tell you everything you don't now know that you need to know. He's going to lead you into all truth. And friends, that was critical for their role here. Because they are talking about Jesus. They are talking about his resurrection. They are talking about the church, which was his kingdom. And in Acts chapter 1, they didn't even know whether this was the time for what kingdom to come. They were the ones asking the question, is this now the time for you to restore the kingdom of Israel? God says it's not in your power, it's in my Father's power, but he will give you that power when he sends the Holy Spirit, and you will be able to speak on this matter. Friends, were it not for the power by the Holy Spirit, allowing these men to speak in these foreign languages to get the attention of the people for their understanding, and then to enable them to have the knowledge of things that they had not previously known. Church could have never gotten its existence. So when you see the church, you ought to see a revelation of the power of God. But friends, very quickly, while we have just a minute left, let me now please help us appreciate something. Man seems to have a great fascination with power. I believe that's one of the reasons that we have all of these modern day interpretations of people being baptized with the Holy Spirit, how that will manifest itself. I don't know about you. Do you get a sense of excitement when you see a great display of power? I don't know how many of you like to watch storms. I had a friend of mine who one time it cost them a little bit. They were standing holding a metal pole watching a storm. But my point is, usually we have a great appreciation for power when we see great manifestations of it. No doubt that was the occasion on that day. But in the midst of all of that supernatural power, please don't miss another revelation of God's power: His Word. His Word. Paul says concerning the gospel, which is the word of God that Peter and the other apostles would be preaching on that day, he said this in Romans 1 and verse 16, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. To every man that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein," in the gospel, that powerful message, "for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith." The gospel is a revelation of God's power. The power to make men who are in sin to be right with God. I think we, sadly, and I say we, not necessarily each of you, but I just think as a generation of people, we have lost a true appreciation for the power of God as seen in His Word. Friends, let me ask you, what does the Bible attribute to God's creative genius? How did He do that? Go back to Genesis 1. The Bible said God said it. All God had to do was speak it, and it came to pass. There is the power of God's Word. When you look at the life of Jesus and His earthly ministry, do you take appreciation for His Word and its power when He was in that boat on the Sea of Galilee? And everyone was scared to death of what power was on display in nature. And God, in the person of Jesus, all had to say was, "Be still." Friends, with Jesus' one word, two words, "Be still," He calmed the winds and the sea. Have you ever taken appreciation for the power of God's Word when grieving sisters welcomed Jesus, but somewhat resenting the fact that He had not been there earlier to save their brother from death? And Jesus goes to that tomb, and all He does is speak words: "Lazarus, come forth." Friends, the Word of God opened the gates of the Hadean realm, called one soul, and it obeyed. Now, why has God's Word lost its power just because it's written down? I think we devalue the power of the Word of God, but God does not, because God says it is the power, my power to save. And friends, let me ask you, when you go back and you read what transpires there in Acts chapter 2, let me ask you, where was the real power? Oh, yes, there was great displays of power. The mighty wind, the fires, cloven tongues, the ability of these fishermen to be speaking foreign languages that they had never learned. But let me ask you, what was it all for? To get the masses of those Jews to listen to Peter and the other apostles do what? Preach the gospel. See, that's where the power really lies. In the Word of God. All the other was provisionary. All the other power was there to allow this preaching to be done accurately and for people to hear it and to listen to it, to give testimony to the fact that this comes with the power of God. It's His Word. And so my questions to you would be, what convicted those present of their guilt of putting to death Jesus the Messiah? It was preaching. What was it that evoked their cry for a remedy of their spiritual desperate condition? They had put to death the Son of God. What can we do? What brought that on? Preaching. What provided an answer to the question? It was preaching. Let me ask you, what changed the hearts and the lives of those 3,000 people on that day? It was preaching. It was the Word of God. When you see the church exists because of God's power through preaching. I believe that is why Paul said what he did. In 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 18, he says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." I believe that's why the Hebrew writer says, for the Word of God is quick, it's living, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and sunder and able to discern the thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word of God is powerful. And when you see the church in existence, when you read about it on the pages of the New Testament, it exists because of the power of God, God's power, effected through the preaching of the gospel. That's the power of God's Word. And friends, you and I know today, as members of that church, that Word is what directs our lives. That Word is what changes us each day closer to the image of Christ. It is because of that Word that we have power to fight against the enemy. It is that Word that provides us the armor that equips us so that we don't have to lose battles with the enemy. It's the Word of God. And very quickly, let me just conclude with this. Have you ever thought about even those who deny God's existence would have no respect or reverence or even regard for the Word of God? Have you ever noticed how often they make promises about they would put the Bible out of existence? You go back and read history. You read the atheist who would say, "I am going to destroy the Bible." Friends, the Bible has been under attack by atheists and agnostics and evolutionists ever since it came into existence. And guess what? All those people and all those claims have not in one way taken away from the Word of God. It still exists today. It is still preserved by the Holy Spirit in this form. It is still this Bible that brings about the conversion of people, making possible the church. It is still this Bible being preserved through the ages against all of those assaults, all of those efforts to put it out of print. It still exists today. You know why? Because that Word is powerful. It is living. It is powerful just as is true of the God who gave it to us. One poet expressed those sentiments that we were just talking about. And I think a very thought-provoking poem. I don't know who the author is, and I'm sorry that I can't give them due credit, but here's how it reads. Last eve, I passed beside a blacksmith's door and heard the anvil ring the vesper chime. Then, looking in, I saw upon the floor old hammers worn with beating years of time. How many anvils have you had, said I, to wear and batter all those hammers so? Just one, he said, and then with twinkling eye, the anvil wears the hammers out, you know. And so, thought I, the anvil of God's word. For ages, skeptic, blows have beat upon. Yet though the noise of falling blows was heard, the anvil is unharmed. The hammer's gone. Friends, when you see the church, I hope it reveals to you the infinite wisdom of our God. But friends, when you see the church, I hope you also have a greater appreciation, maybe a renewed appreciation for God's power. Power put on display in His ability to, by prophecy and promise, predict things that no one else could have done and then brought to pass. Power is seen in the resurrection of Jesus, because without His resurrection, the church would have never been built. Power is seen in its inauguration day and all of the power that God put on display to announce the significance of that day and the resulting church that came into existence. But then, friends, I hope you see the power of God in this word, the gospel, by which individuals' hardened hearts can be softened. A message that can change people's lives for eternity. A message that each day should transform us and change us into the image of Christ. A message that, despite man's best efforts as enemies to assault it and put it out of print, will never do it. Never do it. Because it's the power of God unto salvation. And the only reason the church exists and will continue to exist is because of that word. Let me ask you, have you allowed that word, that powerful word, to affect you? You willing to listen to its message? Are you willing to make the same confession Peter did? I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Are you willing to repent? That's what Peter said, using the keys of the kingdom that were given to him. He told him, here's the keys. Here's how you get entrance. Since you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, repent and be baptized, and your sins will be forgiven, and the Lord will add you to His church. That's how you become part of it. Powerful word of God. I pray we will each yield to that in our stubborn wills and allow God to work His power in us through that message, through the love of Christ. So if we can help you in any way, please let us know while we stand together and sing.